Hi, I'm Dr. Mahadevan.
And I'm Dr. Strelo.
This lecture will cover the second part of treating the moderately dyspneic patient.
Specifically, we will focus on two major modalities, high-flow nasal cannula and non-invasive respiratory support.
What is high-flow nasal cannula therapy? It's a specialized delivery device that is simple and safe. It delivers high oxygen flow rates greater than 30 liters per minute that provide more efficient oxygenation than conventional oxygen therapy.
It allows for heating and humidification, preventing desiccation of the nasal mucosa and that intolerable burning. The silicone nasal cannula fits without occluding the nose.
And this provides better comfort when compared with the masks used in non-invasive respiratory support. High-flow nasal cannula consists of an open circuit system made up of a flow generator, which blends air and oxygen, an active heated humidifier, and a single heated non-condensing circuit that connects to a silicone nasal cannula, which is sized to fit the patient's nostrils. There are two major settings that can be adjusted with high-flow nasal cannula therapy: the flow rate, or air delivered in liters per minute, and the oxygen concentration.
Since the flow seems to help these patients, start with a fixed flow of 30 liters per minute. Although some advocating for starting higher at 60 liters per minute, and start with an FiO2 of 100%.
Start with a temperature of 37 degrees Celsius and adjust it down to 34 or 31 degrees as tolerated by the patient. When weaning a patient, start by decreasing the FiO2 first, then decreasing the flow rate in increments of 5 liters at a time. Why does high-flow nasal cannula therapy work with COVID patients? First, it provides for efficient oxygen delivery, because you're able to maintain a high FiO2 by delivering flows higher than spontaneous inspiratory demand.
And it also reduces the anatomic dead space. During normal ventilation, approximately 30% of the tidal volume is wasted in anatomical dead space that does not participate in gas exchange. High-flow nasal cannula washes out the CO2 of the upper airways, leading to improved ventilatory efficiency and reduced work of breathing.
And finally, high-flow nasal cannula also delivers a small amount of PEEP, 1 centimeter of water for every 10 liters per minute of oxygen high flow, which increases lung volumes and improves gas exchange. So what is the aerosolization risk associated with high-flow nasal cannula therapy? Well, we know from prior studies that a standard surgical mask could significantly reduce aerosolization with high-flow nasal cannula therapy.
While a face mask should be placed on patients who are receiving low or high-flow nasal cannula therapy, such a strategy does not entirely prevent particulate and airflow escape.
This highlights the importance of personal protective equipment, HEPA filtration, and negative pressure rooms as important adjunctive measures. What is non-invasive respiratory support? It's a pressure-targeted respiratory modality that prior to COVID was primarily used for COPD and cardiogenic pulmonary edema. The device comprises a mechanical ventilator attached to a tight-fitting mask.
And it keeps small airways and alveoli open by providing PEEP, positive end expiratory pressure. And it also reduces the work of breathing by assisting the respiratory muscles when you add in biphasic positive airway pressure.
Without PEEP, the small airways and alveoli of COVID-infected lungs collapse at the end of expiration.
With the application of PEEP, however, you can see that these small airways and alveoli remain open, increasing end expiratory lung volume.
There are two modalities of non-invasive ventilation: CPAP, or continuous positive pressure ventilation, and BiPAP, or bi-level positive pressure ventilation.
Both modalities can provide oxygen delivery up to 100% and positive end expiratory pressure. BiPAP also provides some degree of inspiratory pressure.
So what should I start with, CPAP or BiPAP? Well, many patients with COVID-related hypoxemia have a tolerable work of breathing, and so they don't need mechanical inspiratory support, which is what BiPAP would deliver.
But they would benefit from CPAP, which provides enough PEEP to recruit additional alveoli for gas exchange without harmful increases in tidal volumes.
So when should I use BiPAP? Consider using BiPAP in patients with hypercapnic respiratory failure and muscular fatigue, such as those with COPD. It is important to note that CPAP does not actively reduce a patient's respiratory effort, but through alveolar recruitment, improved lung compliance, and reduced ventilation perfusion mismatch, it reduces the degree of hypoxemia even in cases that may have failed conventional oxygen therapy.
In non-COVID patients, you might start with CPAP of 5 to 10 centimeters of water. But in COVID patients, generally start higher at approximately 10 centimeters of water and slowly increase as high as 15 to 18 centimeters of water as tolerated by the patient.
Titrate the FiO2 and PEEP to keep the respiratory rate less than 25 breaths per minute and to reach your target oxygen saturation. Consider using BiPAP with a low driving pressure in patients with comorbidities like COPD. Normally, you might provide 5 centimeters of EPAP and pressure support of 10 centimeters of water.
However, for patients with COVID, start with a higher expiratory positive airway pressure, or EPAP, like 12 centimeters of water, and an inspiratory positive airway pressure, IPAP, of 16 centimeters of water.
Titrate the IPAP and EPAP to reduce the work of breathing and keep the respiratory rate below 25 breaths per minute. Titrate the FiO2 to achieve your target oxygen saturation. As with conventional oxygen therapy and high-flow nasal cannula therapy, there are theoretical concerns about the risk of COVID transmission with the use of non-invasive respiratory support.
If you are going to employ non-invasive respiratory support, these risks can be mitigated by the use of viral filters.
Viral filters are important to creating a closed system and limiting transmission. Attach the filter directly to the mask as long as the filter and the mask are compatible.
Or when using specialized non-invasive machines, which have one limb systems, attach one filter to the inflow limb and another filter to the exhaust port.
Ensuring a proper mask seal is also important. If you're going to employ non-invasive respiratory support, there are some requirements to keep in mind. The patient has to be conscious, able to initiate their own breaths, able to maintain their own airway, and they can't have facial abnormalities that would prohibit a proper mask seal. So how do I choose between high-flow nasal cannula therapy and non-invasive respiratory support? If your patient is in respiratory distress but does not appear fatigued, consider high-flow nasal cannula therapy.
Assume that your patient is fatiguing if they have rapid shallow breathing, are tiring after prolonged respiratory distress, or have asynchronous movements of the chest and abdomen.
If your patient appears to be fatiguing and fails a trial of high-flow nasal cannula therapy, then consider non-invasive respiratory support. This lecture covered the second part of treating the moderately dyspneic patient with a focus on high-flow nasal cannula therapy and non-invasive respiratory support.
We hope you have enjoyed it.